Graphics in general are well suited to handling opaque objects. We can simulate the lighting on the surface with a simple equation, and voila, you have a lit object. But transparent volumes present problems because of their very nature. There's no single surface point to approximate. In fact, if you zoomed in on this puffy little cloud, what you'd find is lots and lots of tiny droplets of ice and water. Light is bouncing around in there, and when taken as a whole, the way they reflect and transmit light inside the cloud is vastly different than a solid object. It begins with an equation called Beer's Law, or the Beer-Lambert Law, and it relates to these kind of semi-transparent materials. It basically tells you how much light gets absorbed, given the distance into a medium the light is traveling. So if our scene here is mountainous, we can fog up the scene by applying this exact equation, exp of negative absorption times the distance. And what happens is, as I crank that absorption slider up, the whole thing fogs up nicely. The fog that started out in the distance starts to creep in a little closer in a somewhat natural-looking way. And it's no coincidence that this basic calculation is one of the classic fog calculations in graphics. And in this case, there's not much you need to know beyond how far away the point is in order to do the fog calculation. If I were to, say, bring an object onto the screen instead, and we want it to be a somewhat cloud-like material, this is a bit different. If you look at the side view of the cube, here's your eye over here, and you're looking in this direction. You need to figure out how far through the object the ray has traveled in order to apply Beer's Law, which means figuring out where it enters and then figuring out where it leaves. Using those, you can calculate the distance in between and apply Beer's Law using the equation above. Given this distance, then, you can apply Beer's Law using the equation above, and voila, kind of gives you that impression of a semi-transparent interior. So yet another problem is that we've made an assumption here, that the density along this distance here was completely constant, that it was the same the entire time. What if it isn't? That means you can't just blindly take this distance, you have to do a bit more work. The next step, then, is to take this vector and divide it into a bunch of segments. Then at each of these in sequence, you can sample your density, multiply that by the segment length, and add it all up. Then you can apply Beer's Law, and now you've kind of got swirls and other stuff happening inside this sort of cloudy interior, so we're making some very cool progress here. It's very flat, though, there's no depth to it. If we introduce a light to the scene, well, nothing happens. We're ray marching through our little density field here, but we don't really have a way to react to lighting. We already know that the further into the medium the light travels, the more it's being absorbed. This is what we use Beer's Law for. But what we haven't figured out is how much light actually gets to any given point. So if you have a light source up here, at each of these points along this path that you're sampling, you need to figure out how much light energy is there by the time you get to that point. And similar to before, since the medium isn't uniformly dense, what you need to do is, starting from each point along here, you need to do a second set of samples towards the light source. Once that code is in place, we can see that the lighting is starting to take effect on our cloudy object. It's looking better already. Jiggle the light around a bit, and the cloudy interior seemingly gets lit properly. Although if you swing the light source behind our cloudy object, you don't get that distinctive silver lining that real clouds are famous for. You're getting a bit of light bleeding through, but it's not the same. This is more smoke than clouds. Why is that? So if we look at a ray of light passing through the cloud, in reality, it's going to get scattered by the water droplets inside. Until now, we've actually been assuming that lighting coming into the cloud is getting distributed pretty evenly in all directions. This is called isotropic scattering. But in real clouds, as light enters the cloud, it doesn't scatter so evenly. It actually has a higher probability of scattering forward. And this is called anisotropic scattering. So you use something called a phase function to simulate that. And a common one is the Henyey-Greenstein model. If we plug this directly into our code and multiply the light energy at any given point by this new phase function, what we end up with is better directional scattering as we move the light around, which is really cool. One of the interesting insights that the original engineers at Guerrilla Games had was that clouds also have sort of darker edges and lighter creases. As light enters a cloud, it begins to scatter. Points closer to the surface scatter deeper into the cloud. points further inside the cloud have actually received more scattered light than points closer to the surface. The end result being that points in cracks and crevices may have gathered more light than points near the surface. The Guerrilla Games engineers called this the powdered sugar effect, because it looks like powdered sugar. And their simple fix was to modify Beer's law a bit and drop off the energy at the start. So you've got exp negative d, which is Beer's law, and you've got this new powder equation, 1 minus exp of negative d times 2. And the combined equation might look something like this, which they called Beer's powder approximation. And in the following years, other papers came out improving the look even further. The folks working on the Frostbite engine for EA released a bunch of improvements to the original clouds. By mixing between a forward and backward Henyey-Greenstein function, they were able to simulate a backscattering component to clouds, improving the look quite a bit. There was also a neat paper from some engineers at Sony Pictures working on Oz, the Great and Powerful, who noted that if they took multiple samples of the scattering, lowering the extinction for each and summing them up, it would allow more light through. It basically looks like this, which you drop in as a replacement for the Beer's law calculation when summing up the lighting. So we've got our little object, and we've walked through most of the calculations necessary. All that's left is actually shaping this thing to be more cloud-like in appearance. And that's where noise comes in. Remember noise? One of my favorite YouTube channels, the Bob's Burger guy, just covered noise in detail. The original paper specified they use something called Perlin-Worley noise, which is a combo of the two noises, although they don't exactly specify how they're combined. So for Worley, you start with this basic grid, and at every cell in the grid, you place a point at the center. Then, using a noise or hash function, you offset it by some point, moving it away. How far is up to you. Then, to calculate the noise for any given pixel, you figure out which cell you're in, and which cells are adjacent. You loop through each of them, figuring out the distance between your sample point and the neighboring cell's offset point, and take the min of all of those. You end up with something that looks like this, kinda organic looking. By inverting the color, you get puffy, billowy shapes. The downside is that this doesn't tile, at least not at first, but there's actually a really simple fix. You modulo the cell offset so they repeat. I was able to do this by adding a single line to the Worley calculation. And voila, repetition in all directions. Perlin has a similar tiling problem. You can see that an FBM texture doesn't tile well here. And unsurprisingly, has a similar solution, a mod on positions in the hash function. And scale that while generating each octave of the FBM. And you've got some nice tiling going on. Easy peasy lemon squeezy. This is where things got pretty hand-wavy in the original paper. Luckily, the Frostbite team goes into more detail. They used multiple octaves of Worley noise to create what's basically a version of Worley FBM, or fractional Brownian motion. Then they used that to remap Perlin noise to get this slightly cauliflower appearance. Stuffing this into a 3D texture, and then using that to carve away pieces, and you start to see the cloud-like features showing up. So, now the really neat thing here is that you can make pretty much any shape you want. If I use SDFs, I can represent cubes, donuts, or even more complex objects. The next issue is that, right now, I've had to constrain the bounds of my cloudy area pretty small. In fact, the bounds of the area that I'm sampling just barely cover what's being shown on screen. If I move the cloud, you quickly see that it runs into the edges of the bounds. But if I expand the bounds out too far, let's say 20x the size of the area, it's quickly apparent that the approach falls apart. Massively upping the number of samples improves the look, but tanks the frame rate. Assuming the clouds are implemented properly, at this point then it's mostly an optimization game. This is where the authors talk about using various techniques to speed things up. They describe using a cheaper sampling approach with larger steps, and if and when they hit a cloud surface, they backtrack and then start using high-quality sampling. I took this a bit further by using sine distance fields to describe the cloud surfaces and use sphere tracing. Check out my video on ray marching for more details. And then I switch to a high-quality sampler when I'm within a certain threshold of a cloud. I also experimented with running this at half resolution or lower and just compositing the result. I mean, it's the cloud, so the details aren't super well defined anyway, or at least that's my hope. It looks all right. Now, there's way more you can do here. I know the FrostBite paper describes amortizing across multiple frames using temporal scattering integration and reprojection to speed things up, but I think I'm going to throw in the towel here. This was a fun little project, and I'm certain that I got a whole bunch of things wrong, but it looks cool, so I can't complain. It's also an amazing illustration of the sheer amount of hard work that goes into just the background details in modern games. Code will be up on GitHub at some point. Cheers.